Hi everyone, welcome to another episode of Coding Adventures. Today, I'd like to take a look at portals. This topic's been on my mind lately because I was looking through some of my old projects and came across this portal effect, which I was very proud of at the time, but which is in fact quite remarkably terrible. Mainly because the view through the portal doesn't remotely align with what you should be able to see. So to try to figure out how to do this properly, I'm going to start with a simplified 2D view of the problem. I have a blue portal over here facing one direction, and a red portal facing some other direction. Then there's the player camera, and I'll shade in the region that it's able to see through the blue portal. So in that space, it should be seeing the world from the perspective of the red portal instead. And one way to achieve this is by adding in a second camera to actually draw that part of the world. Now, one of the many mistakes in my original attempt was placing the camera so that it always looked out from the surface of the portal like so. But if we want its view to align with what the player should be able to see, we need to move it back over here to where it has the same position and rotation relative to its portal as the player camera has relative to the portal that it's looking through. I find maths can be confusing, and I struggled a bit to actually calculate this at first, but what I ended up with was a series of matrix multiplications to get the player camera's position and rotation relative to the blue portal, and then to see where in the world that lands us in relation to the red portal. With these two lines of code, I can now move the player around, and the portal camera will update to maintain the correct position and rotation relative to its portal. This also, of course, works if I move or rotate the blue portal itself, and same story if I move or rotate the red portal. With that figured out, I created a little 3D test world with a simple player controller so I could run about. There are two portals, and each one has a screen for displaying the view from the other portal, and that view is drawn by each portal's camera. Right now, the camera's view through the portal is blocked by its own screen, of course, but I'll fix that in a moment. First, I need a portal script to manage all of this stuff. In the script, I'll tell the portal camera to render what it sees to a texture called the view texture, and then that texture will be assigned to the screen of the other portal. Now, I'll disable the camera because I want to control it manually, so just before the player camera renders the world, I'll call the portal's render function, and in here we should start by hiding that screen object that was blocking the view, then we should make sure that the view texture has been created and has the right size, and then position and rotate the camera using that matrix stuff from earlier. Once that preparation is done, we can instruct the camera to go ahead and render what it sees to the view texture, and finally re-enable the portal screen. That's not quite what I had in mind. It is yelling at me in the console that I forgot to assign the screen object to the portal, but I'm not quite sure why that's causing this to happen. Anyway, I'll assign the screen, and we're now left with a much more boring result, but it's a little closer to what we want. The issue at the moment, though, is that it's taking the view texture from the blue portal and just mapping the entire thing onto the screen of the red portal, like so. It does this, of course, because a regular old shader uses the UV coordinates of the mesh to do texture mapping, and here we have 0,0 on the bottom left up to 1,1 on the top right. So it's going to put the entire texture on there. What we can do instead, though, is use screen space positions, which look like this. As you can see, these go between 0 and 1 on the X and Y axes based on where they are on the game screen. So if we use those for the texture mapping instead, it'll be like taking the view texture and just cutting out the region that overlaps with the screen of the portal. And that's perfect. So this is the current portal shader, and I just need to change a few lines to get it to calculate the screen position for us, and then I'll calculate my screen space UVs by dividing both the X and Y screen positions by the W component. I've always found this a little mysterious, it's just what I've learned you have to do, so I'm going to come back to that in a moment. If we play the game now though, it at last appears as though you're actually looking out through the other side of the portal. They don't exactly take you anywhere when you walk through them though, so that's going to be the next task, right after I get some idea of what this W is doing in my equation. So I've been reading up on how 3D objects get squished onto a 2D monitor. To try and understand this a bit, I have a camera and a model plane. As long as the model is inside of these white lines, which is the camera's view frustum, the camera will be able to see it. Now, the camera has a projection matrix, and the goal of this is to squish everything in its view into a little unit box. If I apply that projection matrix, this happens. not quite achieving the goal. But the result of the projection is actually a four-dimensional vector with the fourth component, or W component, being proportional to the distance from the camera. If we divide the position of each vertex by W, it's now inside the box. This box is useful because it's easy mathematically to tell if a triangle is outside the box, in which case the GPU doesn't have to waste time shading it in. And also, if we just ignore the Z component, we now have a completely flattened representation of our 3D model, which can be drawn to the screen. Hopefully everything I just said is accurate, because my understanding is still a little vague, but I think I've got a better idea now of what this perspective division is all about. I'd really like to learn more about the rendering process though at some point, because it's something I always just take for granted. All this talk of rendering does make me sympathize with the poor GPU that has to render not just the player's view, but also the view from every portal. One small thing I can do to alleviate its suffering is check if the screen of the link portal is visible from the player camera, and if not, I can skip rendering that frame. The visible from camera function will work by calculating the six planes that make up the camera's view frustum using the handy geometry utility, and then check if the bounds of the renderer is inside or intersecting with those planes. I came across this technique on the Unity Wiki, and while I have no reason to believe that Michael is trying to hoodwink me, it doesn't hurt to make sure that it's working how I expect, so I'll quickly make a 1x1 texture, color it red, and apply that to the screen if it's not visible. If it is visible, I'll set it back to the view texture. So now, as I look about, the portals should turn red the moment they're no longer in view of the player. And I can't complain, it seems to be working perfectly. What I will complain about though is that I'm getting sick of looking at these cubes, so I've spent a little time making some low-poly trees and cacti and stuff, and made my testing environment a little easier on the eyes with a forest region and a desert region. I also may have got a tiny bit sidetracked and started working on a silly little system for low-poly clouds. If you put on some relaxing music, I find they're actually quite pleasant to watch. But we don't have time for that. It's 7 minutes into the video, and you still can't walk through the portals. So I've created a little class called Portal Traveler, and anything that wants to go through portals should inherit from that. Then in the portal script, if a traveler comes close, it gets added to a list of track travelers, and if it leaves, it gets removed from the list. Every frame, we can loop over all the track travelers to figure out if they should be teleported or not. So essentially, we just need to check if the traveler is on a different side of the portal this frame than it was on the previous frame. We can do this by looking at the angle between the portal's forward vector and the vector from the portal to the traveler. On the one side, it will be greater than 90 degrees, and on the other side, it will be less than 90 degrees. You might be familiar with a super useful bit of maths called the dot product, and one property of this is that the result will be positive if the two vectors are pointed less than 90 degrees apart, and negative if they're pointed more than 90 degrees apart. So in the code, I'll calculate the traveler's offset from the portal, and also update the previous offset, and then I'll use the dot product to check which side of the portal the traveler's on now, and which side is on previously. If those sides are not the same, then we can do that matrix stuff again to figure out where the traveler should end up, and call the teleport function. Alright, it's a historic occasion, our brave test subject is about to enter the portal for the first time. The crowds are gathered, and the band is ready. Filled with grief and rage, I began debugging, and realized the reason for the traveler's unfortunate demise is that this function that detects when an object leaves the portal depends on the internal physics loop, which runs on its own fixed time step, so there's no guarantee that it will run every frame. For this reason, the same portal ended up teleporting him multiple times, resulting in him being flung unceremoniously into the void. Well, it's working now, but as you might have noticed, there's sometimes a momentary flicker when going through the portals, which spoils the effect a bit. This is caused by the portal screen intersecting with the near clipping plane of the camera, allowing you to see through to the other side. So what I'll do is make the screen actually be a cube. It doesn't need to be nearly this thick, of course. I'll use this bit of code to make it just thick enough to not clip with the camera. Now, a small problem is that if we go inside the cube, it's no longer visible, making the whole thing pretty pointless. However, if we go into the portal shader and add this cull off instruction, that will tell it to draw the inside of the cube as well, and we should now be able to go through portals, reverse through them, and even waddle in sideways without any artifacts. So this is looking pretty good from the point of view of the player going through the portal, but if we're observing something else going through the portal, it looks terrible. First of all, we need the object to be cut off as it goes into the portal. So I'll create a surface shader called slice, and in there I'll add a slice center and a slice normal variable. And in the input struct, I'll request to be given the world position. Then we can calculate the dot product of the slice normal and the direction to the current pixel, which, just like telling which side of the portal the traveler is on, will give us a positive number on one side and a negative on the other side. This clip function in the shader will discard the pixel if the given value is negative, and so I'll pass in that dot product value. While I've been writing this, the car's been struggling tremendously to drive over a little rock. 10 out of 10 for effort, though. Anyway, to see if the slice stuff actually works, I'll make a little test script which just passes the parameters to the shader, and now I should be able to move this plane around to cut off one side of the mesh. It does seem to work, but I'm getting some strange shading on the clipped side, so I did a bit of research and discovered that I need to use the add shadow directive instead of full forward shadows. Perfect. Then I'll need to make a temporary clone of the traveler so that it's able to disappear into one portal while simultaneously appearing from the other. Once the transition is complete, the clone can be discarded. Finally, I'll set the traveler's slice parameters from the portal script like so, and I'll queue up some old-timey music so we can sit back and watch the result in style. Now, there's a pretty big issue that I've been avoiding for a while, which is that if there happens to be an object between the portal camera and the portal itself, then that will block what we're able to see through the portal, completely spoiling the illusion. I had no clue what to do about this, so I started looking at other portal implementations online, and I came across a great article on Tom's programming blog, at the end of which he talks about something called oblique projection. Reading up on this, the maths went way over my head, but the idea itself is very simple. By default, we can adjust the distance of the camera's near clip plane, which lets us cut stuff out, like so. With some fancy matrix magic, however, we can actually rotate the clipping plane. So, of course, if we just align the clipping plane with the portal, then nothing will be able to block the camera's view through it anymore. The code for this is pretty simple, because we just need to calculate the desired clipping plane in camera space, and then Unity thankfully has a function for calculating the projection matrix from that. Just for fun, I added this custom clipping plane stuff to the camera projection test from earlier, and played around with that to see how it affects things. Anyway, with stuff no longer able to block the portals, it was time to move on to the last effect I want to achieve for now, which is recursive portals. In other words, when you can see the portal you're looking through the portal you're looking through. Currently, it's showing whatever was on the portal screen last frame, plus whatever is in front of it this frame, so we get this weird effect where we can kind of draw on the portal by moving around. That's not what I want, of course, so imagine we're looking at the blue portal over here. This means we're seeing the view from the red portal, and from there we can see the blue portal, which shows the view from the red portal, and so on, making an effect like this. Now, we can maybe achieve this by rendering the view once and repeatedly scaling it down or some sort of trickery, but the problem comes if the angle of one of the portals changes. Now the view through the portal will be deflected, and when it goes through the portal, it will be deflected again and again. So in that case, I don't think one can get around the costly process of just rendering the scene multiple times from different points. Here you can see how these points change based on the angle and position of the portal. So in the code, I calculate these points by repeatedly applying the transformation that takes us from the player's camera to the portal camera. And the number of points is just determined by this recursion limit value, because we've got to stop somewhere. I then loop over those points, and each time set the portal camera's position and rotation, and then render its view. So on the first iteration, it renders from the furthest point, and that's drawn onto the portal. Then that gets repeated for the next point, and the next, and so on, until we have the full effect. Now, there's still the question of what to draw on the portal on the first iteration. At the moment, I'm just drawing it black because I can't think of a clever solution. One could maybe make the light fade with each iteration, but I'm not so happy with that either. Anyway, it's obviously extremely expensive rendering all of these extra steps, and so I'm at least going to add a little check to see if the other portal is actually visible through the portal, which is just done by calculating the bounding boxes of the portals in screen space and comparing those. Well, that's all I have for now. There's loads of room for improvement and expansion, but I'm pretty happy with what I have so far. I hope you've enjoyed watching, and until next time, cheers. Thank you.